San Francisco, one of the most culturally sophisticated cities in the world, known for being on the cutting edge of creativity. Tonight, the San Francisco Opera is premiering a daring new production of Mozart's Magic Flute. Moments before the opening curtain, some of San Francisco's arts patrons gather for cocktails and mingle with a surprisingly large number of people from Nebraska.
They flew in from Hastings just to see, just for the opera.
From Hastings?
Yes.
The Nebraskans are all here because of one man, internationally renowned Omaha artist, June Kaneko. In Omaha,
how to move them in and out.
He designed the sets and costumes.
I think this is overdoing it.
For the entire three-hour production.
I really think it works.
But despite the celebratory atmosphere, everyone involved in the production is on edge. Instead of regular stage sets, Kaneko is using 100% projected animation. Projection on this scale has never before been done in opera.
Is that scary?
Of course. Every time you're doing something that's new or different or unexpected, that it's incredibly frightening.
We're nervous as hell.
I'm scared to death.
Just because of this, it's impossible. That doesn't mean you can't do it.
If Kaneko is pushing the entire production team to the edge of what's possible, why are they still laughing?
I'm with you.
The opera is like, oh my God, put on your seatbelt, here we go.
Years of experience have given June Kaneko remarkable powers of concentration, the ability to empty his mind, stay in the moment, and focus entirely on his work. Kaneko came to California from Japan in 1962 when he was 21 years old. As a visual artist, he couldn't have picked a more dynamic time and place. In 1986, Kaneko moved permanently to Omaha after being one of the first artists in residence at the newly created Bemis Center for the Contemporary Arts. From Omaha, he continued building his growing international reputation, primarily in the ceramic arts, building the largest ceramic sculptures in the world. Today, after 50 years of living in America and traveling the world, Kaneko is a cultural fusion of international aesthetics. But running through all his work, there remains an Asian influence.
I think his intensity is probably very Japanese in his focus. I also believe a lot of the fact that he really deals with pure, simple form.
I usually like to go as simple as possible.
Kaneko is discovering that simplicity is elusive in Mozart's Magic Flute. The opera's many scene changes and profusion of characters has confounded stage designers for centuries.
That was my first problem. How do I deal with this? You know, I can't make a good flow. I said, got to be a better way of doing it. And then I thought about projection.
Shocking everyone involved, Kaneko envisioned 156 minutes of animation on 7 screens. The San Francisco Opera's director and production team decided to meet with Kaneko, not in San Francisco, but in Kaneko's studios in Omaha's Old Market, where the ambitious design is fully emerging.
I think the principal risk that we take with this piece, most of the audience will be expecting that there are going to be doors and walls and rocks and trees. We have absolutely nothing like that ever in the production.
Once the projection logistics are worked out, the most difficult challenge becomes the animation. Inside Clark Creative, Fred Clark and Kevin Reiner are just beginning to understand the risks involved.
There's front projections, yeah. There's rear projections, and in front of those front projections are actors crossing through that need to be lit. The animation is a live performance too.
In the opera's very first scene, Kaneko has imagined swirling clouds that pose difficult challenges for animator Kevin Reiner.
After the overture, this is the first thing you see, and
there was a lot of, how are they going to pull that off?
Come in from this side?
Yeah, they'll be flown, just as they were.
In the Orpheum Theater, Opera Omaha is planning on presenting the Magic Flute and is sharing in the pre-production costs. But for Opera Omaha's managing director, Roger Weitz,
there are seven projectors of these.
This isn't as safe as presenting an old, reliable opera.
When times are bad, people tend to stick with what they know. So they go to the old Italian war horses and they bring out sets that are 30 years old and they dust them off and they put them up on stage because they know it'll sell tickets.
But Kaneko's Magic Flute is anything but an old war horse.
In my mind, the best way to energize this community, this audience, that's the question that all of us are facing, or how do we make ourselves relevant? What's so great about opera? Why is it important? And to me, this hit it on all marks. It's risky and it's adventurous to have such a fantastic, contemporary, bold design of a Mozart opera.
After all the design elements are drafted in Omaha, June Kaneko and Ree Kaneko, his wife and production manager, spend weeks in San Francisco working with the costume department, the props department, and the technicians operating the complex set of projectors. But after almost 2 years of being surrounded by borderline hysteria, even the normally calm Kaneko is beginning to get nervous.
Everybody's watching, you know? It's a live music. Every performance is different. This is going to be a tough job.
The opera is a classic fairy tale with a handsome prince who's attacked by a two-headed serpent. It includes an evil queen demanding wicked deeds and naturally has a damsel in distress. After the prince is given a magic flute, he rescues the fair maiden and they are reunited in Kaneko's brightly designed Temple of the Sun. As the cast takes their bows, there is enthusiastic applause. But when Kaneko takes his bow, the entire audience rises to its feet. After 2 years of work, Kaneko has vowed to never do another opera. But if offered a major international production, will he be able to say no?
No problem.